Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Okay, you ready, Bill?
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Prior to calling the meeting order, Vice Chair Bill Ashley is going to offer a prayer and lead us in the pledge. Bill?
Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time thanking you for this day and all the many blessings you share with us. We ask for your guidance in everything we say and do tonight as we do the people's business. These things we pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bill. We'll now call the second September meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners to order. Welcome to all of you. We're glad you're here. Just a couple of housekeeping issues. The doors are going to remain open because apparently the air conditioner is not extending its reach into this room, as evidenced by people fanning themselves. But I think it is comfortable in the hall. So if anybody wants to go out and stay in the hall, I guess they can do that. Second thing is Commissioner Sutton is not with us tonight. He actually has a class that he is attending tonight in Guilford County. It goes until 8 o'clock, and he will not be joining us. However, he has reviewed the agenda. He's talked to our county manager. I have talked to him personally about each of the agenda items that we're going to be discussing tonight. But he's fine. He's just not here. Would like to, at this time, address the public comments. We do have one speaker tonight that would like to come before the board. I'd like to call and welcome Dale Allen. Mr. Allen, welcome to you. Come forward, please.
Thank you. This is the first time I have been here, so I try to write everything out.
Just relax. We're pretty informal. Okay. Here. We're glad you're here.
Let me just let you know who I am. I'm Dale Allen. I reside at 3266 North NC 87, Elon, in the AO community, and with my wife, horses, dogs, cats, and other animals that she decides to rescue. I'm a retired police officer from Burlington and Greensboro. She still works with the Greensboro Police Department and a lifelong resident of Burlington, Alamance County. I'll go ahead and hit the objective part real quick so you know why I'm here. And if I get too long in the subjective matter, you know, cut me right off.
Okay,
right.
Well, you did sign this and know about the three-minute limit.
Yes. Okay. The reason I'm here tonight is I request the commissioners to consider, and I may not do this exactly right in the right language, the legal language, but a motion to repeal Exception 2 under Section 7. Exceptions to the Alamance County Ordinance prohibiting unnecessarily loud, disturbing, and unnecessary noises. And this is in particular in reference to a speedway. I was here this past weekend is what has really just brought this to a head. Let me go ahead and just read it. I'm here to bring the commissioner's attention the issues of excessive noise emanating from the A Speedway on several days and nights now per week. When I moved into the area, it was one night a week. Now it's up to four or five sometimes in days and nights. Events including regular Friday night racing, Saturday racing, Sunday concerts all day, weekday and early evening practice racing, musical concerts, commercial firework displays that are accompanied by concussion charges after the initial fireworks, and concerts that have in the past lasted as late as 12 p.m. to midnight on a Sunday. I have contacted the Sheriff's Department, and I know according to the ordinance their hands are fairly tied. They cannot protect us or ensure our safety and well-being because of the exception to the ordinance. The noise from track can be heard as far away as Indian Valley Golf Course, a fact that I was made aware of by track general manager Brad Allen today, no relation, while I talked with him on the phone during the phone conversation with him today about the most recent disturbance causing concern. On the 15th of September, a racing event was held at the Speedway that began in the mid-afternoon hours at approximately 4:30 p.m. A detonation of some sort occurred. I was on a tractor in the field that caused my neighbor to come down and wanting to know where the explosion was. And I said, I felt it. I mean, I could actually feel it on a tractor. I said, but it came from a speedway. And so he talked, he rode and talked to some other folks. At about 9 p.m., well, then the racing started, and the cars on this date were noticeably louder, and I found out later the reason they are is these were the cars from Bowman Gray, a different level of racing, louder and no mufflers.
And John, that is our limit. Let me suggest, and I appreciate your input, I would like for you to give your information or stick around and talk to our county manager, and I think what we can do is at least have that reviewed by, I guess it'd be Jason's area.
Well, the fire marshal with respect to the fireworks, and also we'll talk to the sheriff's department,
right,
we'll talk to Jason, so we'll be more than happy to review his concerns. Yes, sir.
But make sure you get your contact information to our county manager, and we can review exactly what's going on and how it has changed since you've been there.
May I say one thing? One of the things that this occurred was we have horses, and on this last concussion at 9 o'clock p.m. was such a loud concussion it caused my computer to go off, interrupted cable reception on TVs in the neighborhood, and caused a horse of ours to go through a metal gate and destroy a metal gate. Mm. Not an inexpensive horse, and not good. And I got very irate and took off to the speedway and prayed on the way over there and stayed under control.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, we will follow up. If you would, please make sure that Mr. Honeycutt has your contact information.
Okay.
Any comments from commissioners at this time?
Well, in reference to that, I guess there is a question as to what changes have happened there that's allowing that to happen, and I don't know.
I don't see
anybody here from the Sheriff's Department that might could help answer some of that, but I think that's something we definitely need to look into.
Thank you. At this time, commissioners, we need to review and approve the agenda for this evening. This would include items on the consent agenda. I first would like to request if there are any items on the consent agenda that any commissioner would like to have removed. Let's do that at this time. Are there any?
I don't have any.
Hearing none, the order of the agenda, any issues with that or the items on the agenda? Craig, any changes last minute to the agenda?
No, sir.
And we are going to go into a short closed session, Clyde.
Discuss
a couple of things. Okay.
That's correct.
All right. If there are no changes, we'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda, which would include the items under the consent agenda. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Eddie. Any objections? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.
No, I'm kidding.
You snooze, you lose, lady. Item number 6, we're pleased and proud to welcome Mr. Steve Van Pelt with the Juvenile Crime Prevention Council, who's going to have a short presentation for us with the JCPC chairman, Mr. Stephen Stadler. Welcome to you both.
Well, actually, Tom, I'm the chairman. Stephen's here pinch hitting for Peggy Hamlet tonight. He's the assistant, chief for our district. And Peggy could not be here. She's attending some training out of town. I want to call your attention to a couple things. The first is you have a report in front of you, which is our plan for 2012 and 2013. The information you'll see on the PowerPoint is pulled from there. And, of course, the report you have goes into much greater detail as to about the programs and their description and what they do. But I'd like to call your attention to over here. The JCPC is a definition. The North Carolina Department of Public Safety partners with juvenile crime prevention councils in each county to galvanize community leaders locally and statewide to reduce and prevent juvenile crime. The JCPC board members are appointed by the County Board of Commissioners and meet monthly in each county. The meetings are open to the public, and all business is considered public information. North Carolina Department of Public Safety allocates approximately $23 million to these councils annually. Funding is used to subsidize local programs and services. The next three slides will show you who we have on the who is members of JCPC here locally. Many of these positions are required by statute, such as the chief court counselor, someone representing the district attorney's office, and so forth. And here's the second page. Have someone from the business community, someone from representing the school superintendent, Mr. Sutton, who's not here, is representing the county commissioners. We have a substance abuse counselor, district court judge, and so forth. And we do have some members at large. I happen to be a member at large. I'm completing my ninth year on the JCPC and third year as chairman. And some of these folks with the JCPC members at large, like Granville Simmons, is in charge of the Burlington Weed and Seed Program. Thomas Yancey, the Burlington Police Department Youth Division. Phyllis Walker is a guardian ad litem. Linda Jones is from the Department of Social Services. And Chad Laws is the SRO. Amanda Ferris is a member of DJJ staff. And Melanie Coble is a runs a nonprofit that deals with children. Our local goals, action plan goals, is to reduce the incident of juvenile crime, reduce the incident of gang-related crime and gang involvement, increase school attendance and academic performance, and increase parent involvement and subsequent accountability. Programs and funding, we receive $330,000 from the state, North Carolina Department of Public North Carolina Department of Public Safety, and we get 30% an in-kind match from the county government and the community. Some of our programs are sponsored from the community, and they do provide their own 30% match, generally in-kind, but some may provide some actual dollars there. Here are the programs. We have FASAC Hoops for Hope, which is an alternative to gang activity, sponsored by Burlington Public Housing, Juvenile Restitution Community Service through Alamance Youth Services, Family Conflict Resolution Services, again, Alamance Youth Services, Father Figures and Women on a Mission, People That Care, Structured Day Program from Alamance Youth Services. That's a highly intensive program for probably our most severe youth. Psychological services, again, through Alamance Youth, Teen Court through Alamance Youth Services, and Teen Outreach Program sponsored by the Alamance Health Department. Here's the budget for all these programs. And the last one, I'll bring your attention to that, is JCPC Administration. And no, I do not have a salary. That is to pay primarily for some administrative help to keep things rolling and keep our committee organized. And you can see the Alamance Youth Services is the primary program we fund. All the five programs that run through that program for $220,000. Looking at some statistics, as you can see, if you'll look down at fiscal year 2004, we had 1,026 referrals to the Department of Juvenile Justice here in Alamance County. And you see the numbers, if you'll read from bottom to top, we're looking at this past year, only 630. It's not the lowest, but I think you can see a trend there. We've seen a 38% drop during the nine-year period for Alamance County. And here's the same figure that's graphed. That may give you a better picture that it is going in the right direction. And we think that's good news. The juvenile detention rate, these are for for young men and women that have to be sent to Greensboro basically to be locked up because they've committed some offenses and they are generally a threat to public safety. But not always. Sometimes they have to be placed there because we haven't had any other alternative type of placement, particularly runaways or mom or dad says, you know, you can't come back to the house. And that's it's a sad situation. But if you look at the cost, it costs $244 daily, and that's split between the state and the county. Now, we've been working with a group in Greensboro and working with Mr. Honeycutt, our local judges, and juvenile justice to try to find some alternative to those students that are being placed that really don't need, that are really not a threat to public safety. And we think we found something for just about the same cost. But as you can see, that number's dropped also from 2010 to 2012. We've gone from 1,230 days of detention, it shot up in 2011, but we're down to 941 days in fiscal 2012. YDC commitment, this is the old training school. It's called Youth Development Centers now. You can see those numbers have dropped. Maybe for other reasons, the main reason it's dropped because we don't have as many beds in the state. It's harder to get students or young people committed if they need to go. I think, Steve, do you want to speak on the YDC centers?
Statewide, the trend has been trending down all over the state for juvenile crime, and I think that's reduced the number of commitments just in general. For Alamance County, the commitment rate is the same as last year at this point, but it just varies from time to time. You may have a very low crime rate, but have a very severe crime committed by one or more juveniles. And of course, those kids may need to be committed. So that's a statistic in flux constantly.
When we look at our statistics, we see that really the hardcore doesn't change much year to year. That remains about the same. It's we really work hard to get our first-time offenders and minor offenders, even multiple minor offenders, to get them to the point that they don't come back. And we feel like we're very successful in doing that. The hardcore, that's another matter. And I think this reflects that in what Mr. Stadler said. School complaints, those have dropped. These are the school complaints that have come to Department of Juvenile Justice. You can see in 2010 and compare the number of complaints over the last 3 years. And looks like that some of those are pretty serious when you get into felonies, but the way the state law requires schools to report, you will see that. We're seeing a drop in the felonies and the misdemeanors. We'd just like to see maybe that go, but we're down 24% over the last 3 years. Gangs, of course, this is just anyone under 16. You see a severe spike there in 2011, and I asked about that and found out that was a result of individuals being charged with multiple offenses. I think they had some serious things to go on, and we had multiple charges. But you notice we came back and did a lot better this year. So we think that's and hope that the 79 in 2011 is just that, just a spike. Here's some trends that we're seeing through looking at everything. For the past 3 years, we have been above the state average in juveniles who are under 12 years of age at the first offense. We're trying to serve these students with wraparound services, care teams, multiple strategies here, because that's that's serious, under 12 years old for a first offense. The second is there's a high percentage of substance abuse and other mental health issues. 21 juvenile offenses were drug or alcohol related. Assessments of individuals referred to DJJ indicated that a large percentage of youth are involved in substance abuse. And finally, 20% reported inappropriate sexual behavior at some level, with 5 youths being arrested of specific sex crimes. Here's some school statistics. Short-term suspensions dropped over the last 2 years. Long-term suspensions were up a little bit. And as long as I've been involved with ABSS, there have been very few expulsions. Tom, maybe when you first came on the board, there may have been a couple, but we generally use long-term suspensions rather than expulsions.
I think we've had 2 in the past decade or something.
Yeah, I think I dealt with a couple when I was at the alternative school. And the high school dropout counts, you can see they've dropped substantially from 2006-2007. And we will not have our figures till November for 2011 and 12, and that's because any child that returns to school after dropping out during the first 20 days of the present school year is not counted in the dropout number. So if we have some coming back to school, they won't be counted, but we don't know the 2011-12 until the state gives it to us. What can we do to help? Well, first of all, we need to tell people what we've heard today. We'd let law enforcement and decision makers know that we support programs that are proven to reduce juvenile crime and support our youth by supporting all programs that help our youth become good citizens. These programs include the schools, churches, community-based recreation, art-based programs, scouts, 4-H, as well as programs sponsored by the JCPC and law enforcement. And there's quite a few of those out there. And we can't, as JCPC, we can't take credit for all of that because all these programs are important. And we have to do this as teamwork. We do a lot of teaming with social services, the schools, health department, mental health, you guys sitting here, the law enforcement. It's all a matter of teamwork. And the next question is why? When we know the answer, today's youth are the citizens of tomorrow. These will be the folks who will take care of us when we get older. And they will be the workers, the leaders, the parents, and taxpayers of tomorrow. So we need to do what we can to assure that as many young persons as possible become good citizens. And you guys have any questions?
Any questions for Steve or for Steve?
Steve, on the substance abuse, which is a really serious issue, I think, with youth today, I mean, from some of the statistics you read and so forth, how does your referral work from JCPC to hand off to Susan? I mean, do you have programs in place to address that?
Okay, I'm going to get Steve up here, too, okay. Because he's the one that works with these referrals. But if say, an SRO makes a referral to juvenile justice, then they can make a decision of whether to send that child over to see a judge or defer it. They may send, I guess you could defer a first-time drug charge to teen court.
It depends on the drug of choice. If it's something minor, simple possession of marijuana, a little small amount of marijuana, something like that, we could refer that to teen court. We could assign them a specific number of community service hours in lieu of going to court. And of course, we still have, I like to say that this is going about it the easy way, or you can go about it the hard way. The easy way is we do a deferred prosecute. It's not a deferred prosecution, that's a legal term, but we can send this as a plan to teen court or do community service, and if you don't do it, we can then post-approve the charge and put it in front of a judge, and we go to juvenile court. So which would you rather do, young man, young woman?
So you give them that option up front, and if they work with you, you work with them.
Absolutely.
That's pretty much the answer.
And I think it also depends, Eddie, on how the parents react to this. Parents have to come down to juvenile hall to to talk with the counselor also.
Well, that's good, because, you know, a lot of things that you see, even in the adult era, if you can work on the problem, and some of them it is substance abuse, if you can work on the real problem and then work from there, you may have a better success rate. And hopefully that does work.
Yeah, I want to add one other thing to what I said about the teamwork. And I think one thing that's encouraged this teamwork is the Children's Executive Oversight Committee, which Susan has been a big part of that, and many of us are members of that in a different sort of way. I know, Linda, you've served on that, and it's a matter of getting everything together, knowing what everybody's doing, so we're not repeating that thing, and we're all on the same page.
Very good.
And that's basically what the Children's Executive Oversight, you know, that's what we try to do, is look for a way to keep these kids from being there, you know. And, of course, Lisa Dodson does a great job over there.
Yes, she does.
Well, and Steve, as you said in your presentation, it takes a lot of different people working from a lot of different angles to come together and address some of these issues. So I know you've been involved in it a long time. It sounds like you've got a good core group of people with you on your committee.
Well, we appreciate the county commissioners and what you have done for us, and hopefully what you can help us with in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'd now like to move to item 7 and call on and welcome Mr. Mike Mills. Mike is our division engineer for the North Carolina Department of Transportation, and Mike has a presentation, but also I believe we have to lead off with a public hearing. Is that correct?
Correct. This is our public hearing for our secondary road program.
Okay, and would you like to open, and I guess we need a motion to go into the public hearing.
Well, if I can give the program first,
okay,
and then we go into the public hearing, let them, anybody from the public wants to speak on it.
Okay, and every commissioner should have a map.
Before we get started, thank you, Mr. Chairman and fellow commissioners. Before we get started, I do have several people from my staff here also. I do have Brad Wall. He's our division maintenance engineer. Brad, raise your hand. And Chuck Edwards, our district engineer here in Graham. Hopefully you do have your program in front of you. The very first page, you'll see that we do have $822,525 in available funds. There is not any information on the first page. We are down to 7 unpaved roads in Alamance County. And those 7 have ranged from 1 house on them to 0 houses on them. So we did not put any pavement of the unpaved roads in this year's program. We want to concentrate, if we turn to page 2 roads that we've had some issues with. And the first one is it's a paved road improvement. It's Old Hillsborough Road, and that goes from NC-119 right there at the Hallfields Presbyterian Church over to Mebane Oaks Road, where the Walmart and the Sheets and all that's located. A lot of traffic on this road, and we're proposing on putting 2-foot paved shoulders on this road and resurfacing the road for a cost of $540,000. The second road is Industry Drive from Anthony Road up to Tucker Street. Again, put 2-foot paved shoulders and resurface. But the main reason this road is on this list is if you're coming down Industry Drive towards Anthony, it's a real bad angle there at that intersection. Trucks, if they want to turn right onto Anthony Road, we've had some calls. The truck has gotten, he can't make the turn, and they get stuck in the ditch. I think when I was at an NPO meeting, one of the attendees there made mention of this, that he got called out at night and the truck was blocking the road. It cannot make the turn. So we're proposing on realigning this intersection, try to do everything within existing right of way, we hope to, but make it easier for these trucks to make that turn onto Anthony Road. If you remember, that's a tight turn.
Yes, it is.
Those two improvements is a total of $770,000, and that leaves us $52,525 for some surveying of these projects, road additions, contingency overdrafts, paving fire department driveways and such. And that Mr. Chairman, is our secondary road program for 2011-2012. Be glad to answer any questions from the public at this time on this program.
Let me, before we address the public hearing, let me see if the commissioners have any questions for you about this information and your budget. And I guess the only question I have, when you get to that intersection, if it is a real challenge and you go over this amount, even with the contingency, then what happens?
Well, this is the 2011-2012. We did get funds this past July 1st for 12-13. So anything that overruns in this, we'll pick it up this year. Yeah, we will be coming back to commissioners hopefully in January, February of 2013 with our next year's program.
Okay. Is Lakeview in that?
No, ma'am.
You knew I was going to ask you that.
Yes.
You knew I was going to say that.
Jason did speak to me at our last NPO meeting.
Yeah.
I did tell Jason we were going to look at that. I have spoken with Mike Fox. What we can do is on our 2012-2013, if you would like, because we can, you know, part of this contingency money is for road additions. And Lakeview was recorded prior to 1975, so we can put some money into it for addition. We can't do much, but if you want to, I can at least set aside some money from the 2012-13 down here for funds reserved for road additions. We may have to increase that. We may end up doubling that amount. We'd like to keep about $50,000, $60,000 there for overruns as a rule. But if you want to look at Lakeview, we can certainly add some money to this for that. Right. I need to talk to our board member, Mike Fox, who could not be here tonight on that. But as you know, I've met with Jason several times. We do not have the funds to do all of it. I mean, it's certain criteria.
I understand that because there are so many down in the back that you can't even get to now. But you know,
I think it was looking at maybe trying to get the main road.
Right.
If we could get that, and then work on the side roads another time. But if we want to, we can start on that process, and I can sit back down with Jason.
Okay.
All right, we'll do that.
But all of your priorities and plans go through Jason as far as the contact anyway, isn't that right?
For the road addition for any of this.
I mean what I hope we're not doing is, I mean, no offense to Linda, but I don't want any of us saying, okay, you are gonna put a road here. I mean, it goes through our administrative channel.
On this one, this with a road addition, we have been working with Jason.
Now
usually sometimes Jason may not get involved. The property owners would deal directly with DOT. This one's a unique one. This has been around since probably 1982, maybe before that. It's been trying to get on the system for that long. And I think back in the mid-80s, I think the board member at that time offered to some money to help get the roads up, and the property owners, they had to put up, I think, half the money, and they did not want to do that. So it's been floundering around since the 1980s.
But it's been on your radar.
It's been on our radar. We just cannot do get the whole thing. We're trying to get limited to about maybe $1,000 or $1,500 per house that we can take out of secondary construction money on those. We did do, if you remember, Callaway Drive. We did some of that, and Mountain Trail. We did some of that. We came and we put those on the program, and we put some of this money onto that to bring them up to state standards for addition. And now they're paved.
Oh, Mountain Trail had ruts in this.
It had ruts, yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I showed a house down there one day, and I'm like, I don't want to take my car down here anymore.
I'm sure you're going to get out, right?
I would.
So we can certainly work towards that. I'll get with Jason after maybe this week, and I'll talk to Mike Fox again. But while I'm on Mike Fox, Mike Fox was going to be here tonight. He sends his regrets. He called me at 3 o'clock, and he got tied up with some of his lawyer duties, so he couldn't come.
Thank you, Mike. At this time, I guess we need a motion to actually open and offer a public hearing and see if any folks have anything to ask or comment on to these three individuals or to the commission. Is there a motion to go into and offer a public hearing?
So moved.
I second.
Thank you, Bill. Linda? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, members from the public, would anyone like to speak on Mr. Mills' presentation about the secondary road construction program for Alamance County? We'll just kind of go around the room. Hearing none, Any commissioner have any other comments or questions for Mike?
I just want to thank you.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Trying to do.
Yeah.
I know it's tough because I've been out there.
Oh, yeah. We can. I tried to go through there. I couldn't make it in my car. So.
Jason took me in something. I don't know what.
Right, before you offer your concluding remarks, I think we need to officially close the public hearing. Is there a motion to go out of the public hearing?
I'll make a motion.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
Public hearing.
I second.
Thank you, Linda. Discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're out of public hearing. We welcome you to make any concluding remarks that you would like.
Well, I would enjoy working with the county commissioners, and if we can get approval for a resolution of support for this program, if we can get that. That way we can add to the board, probably be November now, and that way we can move forward with these two items, and we'll try to get those probably let this winter and the work done next spring, early summer.
Okay. Is there a motion for support of the resolution to approve and execute the 2011-2012 secondary road construction program for Alamance County?
So moved.
Bill, is there a second? Linda, any other discussion or questions?
Nothing.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Consider it approved.
And thanks.
Thank
Mike,
you.
For
thank
all
you all.
You did for
appreciate
us.
It. Appreciate yes. it. Tell Mike we said hello. The other Mike.
I'll do it.
This time, item 8, transfer remaining facilities improvement planned into the Capital Reserve Fund. I'd like to welcome Brian Haygood, Assistant County Manager.
Good evening, Commissioners. You should have a memo in your package from me detailing this request. I'm here this evening. The county is winding down the facility improvement plan projects. We're on our last project now. I'll be wrapping it up very soon. It's the 800 megahertz tower over in Mebane. It looks like we're going to have approximately $314,000 left in the facility improvement plan funding, and in fact the funds have also generated approximately $30,000 in interest as well. The original plan from the board was to put this money into fund balance. However, at this time we'd like to request that the board consider moving these funds instead of putting them in fund balance to put them into the county buildings capital reserve fund. There were projects that were bumped out of the original facility improvement plan needs at county buildings that didn't make it into the original plan. We also have issues that come up all the time. In fact, the one pressing item we have right now is a fire alarm system in this building. I think county managers made you all aware of that. It has failed, and we'd like to be able to use some of these funds if they're moved from where they are now in the facility improvement plan over into the Capitol Building Reserve. They would be able to be used to address issues like that when they come up. What we would suggest doing is leaving funds in the facility improvement plan slot to carry the 800 megahertz tower project through, as well as leave some funding in there, approximately $8,900, as a contingency for that project, which if you approve this shift tonight at the end of the 800 megahertz tower project, if there's any of those funds remaining, they would also be swept over into the capital fund. So do you have any questions about this? Basically what we're recommending is instead of the $314,000 that's currently left and the $30,000 in interest, instead of it going into fund balance, we're recommending that it go into the county buildings capital reserve fund to be used on additional county building needs.
And part of this reasoning that we want to bring it back to you, instead of just putting it in fund balance, instead of taking money out of fund balance for these capital projects that we haven't budgeted for, such as the fire alarm, there'll be a pot of money that is set aside just for facility issues. And that's kind of the thought process that we had. And again, as Brian mentioned, that we, you know, this is going to be above and beyond our regular maintenance budget. That any project that we would take out of this funding will be over $10,000, and we would come to the board with your approval before moving any of that money. So it would be for projects and maintenance and repairs over $10,000, but again, we would not do anything without the board's approval.
Well, where would that address what you had?
The alarm system.
Yeah, the alarm system. Is that a project
we would come back to you and say that the alarm system is, you know, $40,000-$50,000. We would like to move it from this pot of money.
The fund that this money's
yes,
going
sir.
Into.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And to move that remaining amount, you need a motion and approval, actually a motion and a second and approval from this board to get that done.
That's correct. Yes, sir.
Any questions for Brian? Is there a motion that we transfer the remaining facilities improvement plan funds into the capital reserve fund?
I'll make that motion.
Thank you, Linda. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Eddie. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Thanks. The next item on the agenda is, it says evaluation discussion. I had asked over the past, few weeks and months to gather some data that would allow our board to review, assess, define the job responsibilities of the three positions that report directly to this board. And those three positions are the county manager, the county attorney, and the county tax administrator. Between Craig and Tori and the School of Government, with Ms. Upshaw's help, I guess, who was kind of a specialist in this area, we pulled together and kind of narrowed down to just a couple of samples, and that's all they are, is samples of forms and information that other counties are using. And what I'd like to do tonight is simply distribute these sample forms to the commissioners. I've talked to Tim about it. This is not in connection or tied to any kind of compensation change. It's strictly just as Craig evaluates his department chairs and the department chairs evaluate their people. It'd be nice, I think, on our part and on these three individuals' part to have that kind of analysis. And I do want to read two sentences that came with one of the emails from Ms. Upshaw. And she is specialist with the School of Government in Chapel Hill. And she said, as far as the board's role in this, some of the things that we should think about once we define kind of responsibilities, accountabilities, how has the Board of Commissioners contributed to the manager's success or the attorney's success this year? And is there anything, what might the Board of Commissioners do differently next year to improve the manager or attorney's successor's success? So I think it'll be good not only to kind of define roles from the standpoint of what the expectations are, but make sure our expectations and their understanding of our expectations are the same. And again, it's really no different than any other. If you're in an organization, you've probably seen something like this somewhere. But you've never really had, my understanding is, you've never had an evaluation.
That's right.
And Clyde, you have not?
Only in court.
Yeah. And I don't think Gerald has either, but that's another point. You know, we have talked, and Gerald has kind of laid out, you know, his succession plans over the next now 10 years. But as part of that, it would be good to have a tool in place for when there's eventually a new person in the slot, kind of what do we want to do?
And what our expectations are of them.
Exactly. So what I'd like to do is just simply give each commissioner one of these, and Tori, if I can give you one for Commissioner Sutton. But also I'd like for Clyde to take the attorney one and Craig to take the manager one, and you guys look at it and, you know, bring out your red pen and see what makes sense and what doesn't. And I guess what I'd suggest is maybe with your input and what we see, let's come back and take the next step, which would be, okay, how can we apply this to Alamance County? Is this good? Do there need to be changes? Are there things that are on here that don't apply? Are there things that aren't on here that should apply? One of them, for instance, has a scale from, you know, you always do it, you never do it, and the other one's more narrative. I think we probably ought to be consistent once we decide which way to go, but I don't have any feeling at this time which would be better. I think we need to hear that from you. And Tori, I'd like to continue to try to find something that would address the tax administrator's position as well. Those are the three that report kind of to the board. Now, Tori is secretary to the board, but also is administrative assistant to Mr. Honeycutt. Mr. Honeycutt hired her, so unless you guys want to, we'll let him do that one. But I've got enough of these for anybody in the room that would like to see it. As I said, these are just sample forms. What I'm going to do is pass two this way. I'm going to pass one this way, and then the others I'm going to keep one myself. If you would just pass those maybe to Tim's seat, and Craig and Clyde can get them and distribute them. That's for the county manager. I have another one for the county attorney. And again, I just want to get it out there. As I said, I've talked also to Commissioner Sutton about this, and he is supportive of the concept as well. So I'm going to give you those two. Keep one, you one, pass the others around. Any reaction?
This is something like we had to do in Orange County to do for evaluations.
When you were employed with Orange County?
I appreciate this because I think this will help the ones that are reporting directly to us to know really what we're expecting of them, because I know sometimes there's that kind of nebulous thing out there and they don't really understand what we're looking for. And so I think this is a step in the right direction to help them do their job better, because we, as their boss, being the board, we need to express what we like about what you do and what you don't do.
Well, I think the other frustration is most people in organizations have one supervisor, sometimes two, but one, most of the times they have one. And these two individuals have 20% of five.
Right.
And so they might be hearing different things from different people. So I think it would be good going forward to have an understanding where the board buys in. Mm-hmm. So, okay, yeah, this may not be the perfect thing that I want to do, but for the board as a whole, that's the direction we need to go.
Right.
Okay, well, that's all I had on that. If, I would like, kind of as a homework assignment, if you can kind of look through it and just make comments, middle notes, whatever. And I would say probably at the meeting, maybe the second meeting in October, we can take the next step. That gives everybody kind of 30 days to play with it and do some research, if that'll work.
Yes, sir.
Is that all right?
Yes,
sir. Okay, well, that's all I have on that. Craig, you have a report for us?
I just wanted to kind of give a public update on the fire alarm system that we kind of discussed briefly. Is basically, we have a 40-year-old fire alarm system in this building that's kaput. On its ever-loving last leg. So we have been working with the Grand Fire Marshal, and since this is a public building and publicly occupied and is basically occupied this building 24 hours a day, we have to have a fire watch under statute. So our during the day from 8 to 5, we do have our safety committee walking around every hour, checking to make sure everything is fine. However, at night, in this building, not in the courts building, but we do have to pay someone from 6 o'clock p.m. to 6 o'clock a.m. to walk around the building to make sure, and that's required by the Grand Fire Marshal and statute. So we don't have to do it in the civil courts building, but we do have to do it in this building. So
has anybody checked the statutes to make sure that it's there?
Yes, sir.
Because I just don't trust the fire marshals. I think they overstep their authorities time after time.
Yeah. We did check.
Okay.
We did check. And so we're in the process. We're having to do that. But the process now is we are having somebody from Simplex coming in on Wednesday, who's kind of the guru of the older fire systems, hopefully just to get it to the point where we don't have to do the continual 24-hour fire watch, but we still have to replace the system. And so we kind of need to do that really ASAP, and that's going to cost anywhere between $40,000 and $60,000.
What is it costing us for this person at night?
I think we're paying $10 to $15 a night.
For 80 or 90.
So that's 150 bucks. That's okay. 12, maybe 200 bucks fine. You know, so
it adds up pretty quick.
It adds up. So we're the Band-Aid for just making it work may not work. You know, however, we're moving forward as quickly as possible to get the system replaced and replaced right. So just wanted to give you.
So we're talking total replacement as opposed to upgrading, and
it's kaput. At least that's what we've been told. It's dead. Is life support's there and the plug is halfway out.
So what building are you talking about? Just this building?
Well, it's this and the criminal court.
Okay,
building
but the building,
well.
That's, yeah, right. It's all connected.
Right. But we don't have to do the fire watch at night on the criminal court's building because it's not occupied. It's only this building that's occupied. 24/7 with.
But they're tied together right. Though on the same system.
They are. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Well, can you not take it from that fund that we just transferred that money
to? We will be able to use some of that fund, yes, ma'am.
Okay. Sounds good.
And say again where the daily or nightly supervision, where was that? Where's that requirement from?
It is fire marshals from code and statute, fire statute.
Because we have a CCOM.
Because we have CCOM.
Yeah, I just wanted the source of
public, it's a public building and it is publicly, you know, or is occupied 24/7. The fire watch is required. Yes, sir.
How many people are in the CCOM department?
At night,
I think there's 12, isn't it?
8 to 12.
Yeah, the shifts vary depending on their.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering if one of them could walk around the building during the break.
They require a continual walkthrough. And the issue of having CCOM do it was in case they did get busy and then they couldn't walk through,
it
just became a huge.
Well, get busy and get us some numbers.
Yes,
well,
sir.
I think we have to do it only because of what happened up the road.
Right.
If we hadn't had somebody just happen to pass by when the, you know, the renovations were going on, we wouldn't have that thing today the way it is.
Right.
So.
But I just, again, it's not something we're thrilled about, but we will comply and we'll try to do it as quickly as possible so we can get it resolved. So, and that's all I have.
That's all you have?
Yes, sir.
At this time, I would move that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute. This section is 143-318, period 11A3, in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners, and receive a report regarding the case of the Triumph LLC versus Alamance County and Caswell County and the Alamance County LME. Also, to get an update on the Department of Justice case versus Alamance County and the Alamance County Sheriff. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Eddie. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We'll go next door. Clyde, for how long?
10 minutes at the most.
Yeah, that's what Steve Van Pelt said.
Steve didn't bring his watch.